Our understanding of how plastics act as pollution in the environment is a relatively new field. This is a topic that's really gaining in public interest, and as a result, our scientific interest into understanding this problem has also really developed in the past few years. Certainly others have studied plastics. We know a lot about, for example, how plastics can act as vectors for organic pollutants. We know that toxic pesticides, for example, can really easily adsorb to plastics. And we know that once contaminants are adsorbed to these plastics, they can be ingested by organisms, move up the food chain, and lead to bioaccumulation and biomagnification of these contaminants. What I found in the literature had been studied a lot less was interactions between metals and plastics. It's something that we normally wouldn't think of having a strong attraction towards each other, as plastics generally have a neutral surface charge. But we found that as plastics degrade in the environment, they can develop these surface charges and actually have a capacity to attract and accumulate toxic metals on their surface. What this study is focusing on is, as those plastics enter into the environment, what effect does the environment have on how those plastics degrade in the environment? For example, what happens when those plastics are exposed to sunlight? What happens when the plastics are in salt water versus fresh water versus on land? We expect that all of these different environmental conditions will essentially change perhaps the rate and also perhaps the type of degradation that these plastics undergo. So I first placed these plastics out in the environment back in July, and I have three field sites located throughout New Jersey. And the goal is to go back and check on these plastics once a month. So I get in my waders, I head out into the water. This was a lot more fun in the summer than it has been in December and now in January. And I go and I remove a segment of the plastic each month, prepare it back in the lab, and do my chemical analyses of changes in the plastic surface month to month at each of these field sites. And then the second aspect of what we do is at these synchrotron particle accelerators. The one that I go to is at Brookhaven National Lab. And what we can do is essentially map out all of the inorganics, the metals that are bound to the plastic surface. And we can actually create and visualize in two dimensions what is present on the plastic surface and compare between these three different field sites to see what effect, for example, differences in salinity are having in terms of exactly what metals are present on the plastic surface and compare between months as well. What I would say so far is that in all of our work so far, we've been surprised with how many inorganic species are found on our plastic surfaces, how quickly this occurs, and also the influence of the environment on these types of interactions. So I would say that certainly it fits in line with what others have seen, that these plastics do have the potential to be binding these heavy metals and that this really is a topic that we should be studying. The goal of this is to use this information to really inform our design of our next generation of plastics. We're currently undergoing these efforts to redesign the plastics that we use every day. And in order to avoid making the same mistakes twice, we really need to understand these processes that are happening to our current generation of plastics to figure out how things like toxic metals are accumulating so that now when we're redesigning these materials, we can avoid doing that with our next generation of plastics. Plastics are something that we use every day. It's hard to imagine a society where we're fully devoid of plastics, but how can we be intentional about how we use plastics, the types of plastics that we use, in order to minimize unintended environmental negative consequences?